There are two issues here. One issue is that what are the solutions to the problem of generality of the poor and poor who are excluded and discriminated. Those who believe that there is no difference between the poor and the poor from excluded community, in my view, their position is wrong. There are differences. That is what Ambedkar's position was. That's why he formed Independent Labour Party. He didn't join the Communist Party. So one has to draw a distinction that the problems of the poor and problem of the excluded group who are poor are different and they have to be dealt differently. Similarly, but also differently. Now, there are two questions which are raised here. One question is larger question. What solution, what are the solution for the problem of Dalit, for example? The solution that are raised very clearly even yesterday, Gopal Guru, Dr. Ten Tumble, that the structural issues are important, that your economic and social structure should be such that it is pro-poor, that it remove poverty and help reduce marginalization. So there are larger structural and general economic and social policy. The second issue is that within that broader policy, that there is a need for policies for the excluded group. You may call reservation, you may call affirmative action. I'll come to that. What's the difference between the two? But in addition to the general policy of economic empowerment and social empowerment, you do require an additional and supplementary policy of affirmative action. Not that the affirmative action policy is the main policy and economic empowerment is the supplementary policy. No, one has to reverse that. Economic empowerment, restructuring, redistribution of resources to the poor is the main policy. The policy of affirmative action for the excluded group is an additional policy, a complementary policy, a supplementary policy. So they are mutually inclusive, they are not mutually exclusive. Some of them have put, I think Teltumble has put it, or. It is not and or. I think they are supplementary. That is how Dr. Ambedkar did it, that you require affirmative action policies or remedies against discrimination as a supplementary and complementary policy rightly for the redistributive policies. Now, let us take this issue. This has ideological underpinning as well as operational underpinning. Now, what is Ambedkar's position on this? One of the person who has really addressed the issues of Dalit, and also this will impinge upon the issue of the African American. The first paper of Dr. Ambedkar, last paper of Ambedkar, Karl Marx and Buddha. What is the final position of Ambedkar? Final position of Ambedkar is that the roots of the poverty lies into the distribution of private property. So unequal distribution of private property is the source of the miseries of the poor. First, you may agree, disagree with him. Solution is dismantle the private property, nationalize the land, redistribute it, and organize on the collective form or distribute equally and have a peasant farming. That is his final word in Karl Marx and Buddha. Now come down to the program in 1946. This lecture is 1956, but prior to that, the Karl Marx and Buddha's lecture is included in state and minorities. State and minority is the last solution of Dr. Ambedkar. All wisdom of his life is culminated into the state and minority, not in any annihilation of caste. Forget about it. Annihilation of caste is the analysis of how to overcome caste system and what are the ways. But the ideology and the policy and the strategies and the solutions are in state and minority, which was submitted as a memorandum to the Constitution Assembly, to the Fundamental Rights Committee, that should we have economic program in addition to the political program. What is the solution of Ambedkar in state and minority? Remedies against economic exploitation. He used word exploitation. Is to go for a state socialism. Forget about state socialism. Who brings state socialism is a different thing. But he talk of socialism. What do socialism include? Nationalization of land and collective of land, cultivation of land and the collective farm. Nationalization of industry, nationalization of insurance, education and health. This is a strong socialist program. So this is the redistributive program which he talks about. So nobody deny that we do not require a redistributive program. We do require, and there is no substitute for that. Remember well, Reservation is not a substitute for redistributive program. I agree with those who say that. But Dr. Ambedkar doesn't stop there. He has a second para, remedies against social discrimination. Because he knows by economic equalization by itself will not remove the discrimination altogether. It might give a food for you to eat, but the discrimination might prohibit you. Discrimination in employment, discrimination in working together might deny the equal opportunity to the discriminated group. The officer sitting here, that even in public sector there is a discrimination. Public sector doesn't guarantee you discrimination. And I can give you a classical example. That classical example is that you have a special component plan by the decision, administrative decision of the government, 1975, implemented by Andhra, implemented by Karnataka, not implemented by bureaucrats, public sector. So what do you require? This is perhaps somebody should educate me, that you require a law to compel the bureaucrat to implement their own decision. So you brought a law for special component plan in Andhra. I mean, this is amazing. You have an administrative order of the government for special component plan, and you require a law to enforce the government officer to implement special component plan, because discrimination can exist even in public sector. So Ambedkar then took a position that you require a supplementary and complementary solution for overcoming discrimination, and he provided safeguards. What are those safeguards against discrimination? In addition to the program of nationalization, remember well, in addition to nationalization of land, in addition to industries in public sector, in addition to have a public sector insurance, education and health under public sector, he only left out small scale industry and medium industries to the private. Now, in addition to that, he is proposing these remedies against discrimination. What are those remedies? First, law against untouchability and discrimination, caste, which USA has, which every country has, wherever there is a discrimination exists. Second, that law by itself will not remove discrimination, and it will not provide equal participation. So therefore, he suggested reservation. You may call it affirmative action, but reservation. What does reservation mean? Reservation means two things in this present context. Remember well and understand well. That is, there are two components of reservation. What is the logic on the basis which you can justify special provision for African American, or for that matter woman, or for that for matter scheduled caste? Because for 2000 years they were denied equal opportunity. They were denied right to act. They were excluded from the right. Tiltumde asked this question. He must understand that untouchable were denied right to property. Not because of capitalism, not because of feudalism, but because of the rule of the caste. Remember well, that the religion here enters into the capitalism, religion enters into feudalism, and put obstacle. It is not alienation. The concept of alienation of Marx is different than the concept of exclusion of Ambedkar. Because of the injection of the religion, that untouchables are not allowed to undertake the production of goods, except the polluting goods. In a memorandum submitted to the South Bureau Committee, Ambedkar has a statement there in the discussion that a Mahar woman was arrested in Bombay because she sell watermelon. And she was arrested by the police under the law that a Mahar woman cannot sell consumable goods. This is restriction on your sale. Forget about production. The issue is that untouchable were denied right to land. That is why there was a compensation measure. They were denied right to private property, private entrepreneurs. They were denied right to education, not because of poverty or capitalism or feudalism, but because of caste. This distinction has to be made. Denial of illiteracy because of poverty and illiteracy because of caste restriction are two different things. When Britishers introduced primary education in Bombay, in middle of the 19th century, it is the high caste Marathas opposed, Brahmin opposed, that we will not allow Maha to enter into the public school. The Britishers has to pass an order to punish the Patil of the village. That if they don't, they will be put into the jail, and that is how then mixed school gradually began to emerge. So one must understand that when Dr. Ambedkar talk about an additional remedy of safeguard against caste discrimination, he believed that the discrimination and exclusion in economic sphere and social sphere that comes through the root of religion is equally strong, and you require a special measure for that. Now, so affirmative action policy or reservation he proposed for two reasons. One, as a compensation measure for the denial in the past for 2000 years. That's why the African American talks about reparation. That's why UN talk about reparation and compensation. And therefore, land distribution is necessary. Therefore, policies for promoting the enterprises and giving capital is necessary. Policies to stop discrimination in sale of commodities is necessary. It has no ideological connotation. This is for the past, exclusion and discrimination. But what about you do about the present? The discrimination in the present also continue? You can compensate them for their denial for the several years, several thousand years. But despite that, even if you give them land and private entrepreneurship, for example, and once they interact into the economy, they face discrimination. Now, therefore, you require a safeguard against discrimination in the present. That is why you require a law in the present. You may give the land distribution, give the land to them as a compensation, but you also require the protection in the present. Indian states have also gone for a reparation or compensation of their own way. Gail has brought it out. Andhra Pradesh has a depressed class land distribution policy. Tamil Nadu has a Panchami land policy. Maharashtra has Maharvatan and land distribution policies. These were compensatory measures. Panchami was brought by Britishers when a British officer came to know that untouchables are completely landless and they are not allowed to have a land. They brought Panchami land policy and distribute the land to the Dalit. This was compensation. This is not given to the poor non-Dalit. The poor non-Dalit can buy land in the market if they have money. But untouchable, even if they have money, they cannot buy. Customary rule, as I said yesterday in my lecture, the customary rule of not allowing Dalit to own the land was converted into a law in one state. We know only one state. We do not know in other state whether the law was there. Ambedkar writes only about the Punjab Land Annihilation Act, whereby law untouchable were not allowed to buy the land. On the basis of what? On the basis of caste custom, not on the basis of capitalism and feudalism. They were not allowed to buy land. So 1901 to 1947, untouchable could not buy a land. It is only 1947, after Dr. Ambedkar became law minister, that law was removed. And I do remember, I went to for a field work when I studied market discrimination in Haryana. The scheduled caste Valmiki, some of the government officials, they told me that my father purchased land who was in the military on the name of Jat, because we were not allowed to buy the land. One must understand the restriction of caste and the damage that the caste has played in terms of ownership of land and property. Forget about civil rights. I'm not talking of untouchability at all. I'm talking of economic rights. So you require a safeguard in the present also. That's why affirmative action policy and reservation is required. But Ambedkar also talked about two more things which we are facing now. And those safeguards we have not accepted. And those safeguards are, imagine, the foresight of Ambedkar, he said, I don't believe the legislature dominated by the Hindu. There is no guarantee in the parliament and the state legislature. The word that he used is they will be insensitive, not that they will be against. Insensitive, prolonged. The Atrocity Act has been prolonged. Reservation Act has been prolonged. Right to Food has been prolonged. He said, I need a protection against legislation also. That legislation would not allow to take any steps, legal step, which will be detrimental to the interests of the Dalit or the excluded group. And then he goes ahead, protection against the bureaucracy, administrator, because they will also discriminate. Imagine the protection that he wants. Law against discrimination, policy for compensation of discrimination in the past, policy for safeguard against discrimination in the present, policy of safeguard against the legislation, policies of safeguard against the bureaucrat. Why? Because the caste system is so deeply rooted. The scheduled caste on day-to-day basis face a denial. It is so intense and in-depth that they are, on a day-to-day basis, they are denied their right. And if they try to seek an equal right, the caste system provides an instrument of social ostracism, economic and social penalties. Therefore, Ambedkar, in that safeguard against discrimination, in addition to this package of this affirmative action policy, also suggests a separate settlement. He was not hopeful. He has no hope that in rural area, untouchable will get a justice from the law of untouchability and Atrocity Act. No. Because he say high caste Hindus are deeply religious, traditional, are in majority economically strong. Dalits are in minority and economically dependent on scheduled caste. And beside you have this strong hanging sort of social ostracism, which Dalits are using now, high caste are using. You have to see the atrocities being committed and the instrument of social boycott used by the high caste. Literally, you can compare with the prescription given by Manu in 200 AD. Similarly, exactly. Now, in this situation, you require a protection. So the point that one has to understand is that please don't push this debate or against. No. I agree with Til Tumble that you require redistribution policy. Unless you have a redistribution policy of land, capital, education, reservation will have a success, but it will have a limited success because reservation is not considered as a major solution. It is considered as a supplementary solution, as a safeguard against discrimination, but inevitable. You cannot say that if I have a redistribution policy, I won't have a safeguard against discrimination. Why? Let me give another example now. This is an ideological issue. This comes from the Marxist ideology that economic structure, equalization of economic resources will eliminate all distinction because religion, caste, and similar institutions are considered to be superstructure, dependent on the economic structure. That was the wisdom that has governed Dange and everybody. But this question was raised to Engels during that time, that please clarify. Marx was no more there. Please clarify what is the relative role of superstructure and economic structure. That there are young Marxists who emphasize much more on economic structure and says that economic structure is the only determining influence in the life of the people. Another factor do not matter. Engels respond. These letters are given in the Grandeis. You should read. And Engels say, and I quote, because I am interested in this superstructure and structure debate, so I have almost remembered them. Engels says that, look, there are multiple factors that decide the course of society and the people and their government. Multiple factors. At the end of it is the economic factor which is the predominant factor. And he says this doesn't mean that other factors are not important. The only concession he makes and say that some other factor may be important at some other time. So if caste and religion is important in Indian society at a given point of time, you have to address. And Engels was so scared that he went ahead and used the statement that if this is the understanding of the young Marxists about Marx, then I am not a Marxist. It is in this context he used that word. So what we have to do, that even by the Marxist analysis, we have to give a due consideration to the non-economic consideration. Now let me come to the Marxist societies and experiment. The Soviet Union experience has failed. European experience has failed. And people use this as an argument against Marxism, which I do not buy. The basic arguments of Marxists are there. Inequality, the working of the capitalism has its own outcome. You have to read the Piketty's book. 1% of people owning 90% of wealth in USA, and statistics were given even for other statistics. Then, a book by Atkinson for UK, Inequality, What to Do. All are talking about inequality working of the capitalist economy. Nobody denies about the problem. But has the problem of equalization of poverty in Soviet Union and in China bypassed the, solved the problem of discriminated group? No. Forget about Soviet Union. We have a living country, China. There was a complete collectivization of land and industry and everything. And yet, right in 56, look at the foresight of Mao, who talk about cultural revolution. He set up a minority institute in Beijing. For what? To give a due representation to 56 minorities on Northwestern side in politics. Because he was aware that minority will not get an equal space in the Communist Party. And so he set up a minority university for education. And eventually what happened? For 56 minorities, even after socialism and progress, they have affirmative action policy, a strong affirmative action policy for minority. In education, in employment, in politics. That minority institute is converted into a minority university now. It is next door to Beijing. So economic restructuring has its own limitation, although it is essential. I will hold that view that that is not a substitute for reservation. You have to have redistribution policies, but this is not to say that you don't require policies for discriminated group. because economic equalization by itself will solve the problem. No. Mao showed that, no, you require additional measures. So I think, now let me come to the discussion here. If we accept either from ideological point of view and the point of view of experience, that we require dual policies. So I will not misunderstand a viewpoint which talks about redistribution is key thing, economic equalization and other things, that is must. But it cannot be with the exclusion of the affirmative action policy. You cannot have, because the excluded group will not get the equal share. That's the example of China, that's the example of many other countries. Now, what nature of affirmative action policy? There is a confusion between affirmative action and reservation. There is no confusion. They are one and the same strategies. To provide and safeguard and to give and compensation to the excluded group for several years, you have an policy. What does that policy does? That policies believe that even in the present, discrimination will be there. So the African American will not get an equal share in employment, equal share in education, equal share in politics, equal share in capital. Therefore, you require a policy whereby you give share. What is the solution? First, have a legal measure that nobody is allowed to discriminate. If you discriminate, individual has a right to go to the court. That's the liberal solution of the problem. It has been suggested, anti-discriminatory law. But that is the first step. But the second step is law by itself doesn't give you equal and fair access. Millions and millions and people who discriminate on a day-to-day basis in India cannot go to the court, and they are so poor that they cannot use the court. Court is hardly for the poor. So what you require, that you have to have a supplementary policy in addition to the anti-discrimination policy, that we will have a policy which will ensure an adequate participation and share for the discriminated group. I underline participation and share for the discriminated group in education, in employment, in politics, and in capital now. We must talk about capital. I'll come to capital and labor for dilemma now. And I'll take the issue that 1% of organized labor, that I'll take that issue also for discussion. That point is important and relevant. So you require equal share because you are not given that equal share through the denial. And law doesn't help you. How do we provide equal share? We accepted a very strong method and good method, which all my American economists, who are my close friends and who work on this, they say, you have a better system than us. What does it do, this quota does do? It only estimates and ensure that, Baba, at least this, you measure their fair share in terms of their population. In USA, what do? They don't have a quota. But at the back of their mind, what is there? At the back of the mind is that blacks are underrepresented, isn't it? Now, how do you measure underrepresentation in America? All of them, they told me that you always see the population share of black, 12%, 13%, isn't it? So they are also doing the same thing. We are also doing the same thing. The only thing that they are not doing is that they are not quoting the figure, but they are doing precisely the same thing. There is a word, disparate impact. You are the lawyer, isn't it that word? Yes, yes. That if the underrepresentation is how do you say the underrepresentation and closely related to discrimination, they use the word disparate impact on the African American. If the underrepresentation is such that it will have a bad impact or disparate impact, then we say that there is a discrimination. The same approach is there, the only thing the solutions are different. Let us take Northern Ireland, Equal Opportunity Commission, Employment Commission. What does Northern Ireland does? Because the Protestants are discriminated by Catholic, they have an affirmative action policy of a different sort. They set up an employment opportunity office. And what do they do? They have made a rule that every industry will submit the religious background of their employee to the employment commission. And once the employment commission get that statistic, and then they see that in certain area, there is a certain population of Protestant and Catholic. If the population of Protestant is 50%, but their share in employment is only 20%, so there is something wrong. They are not getting their due share. So the employment commission will write a polite love letter to that particular company that what is the problem? The population of Protestant is 30%, 50%, but your labor force, their share is 20%. Immediately the company will respond and improve the employment. Why? Because that letter will be released in the press and that company will go to dock. There is a social pressure. All objectives are the same, to ensure fair share. The instruments are different. Why do we criticize quota, which is the best one compared to the American system? They are now, there are many economists, I know they say we should imitate from Indian experience. So the affirmative action or reservation, they are the word which are used in a very different way. This should, and turn out to be great debate. I know my friend, several of them from JNU, reservation versus affirmative action. That's not the issue. Issue is how do you measure underrepresentation? How do you ensure equal presentation? One in one case is quota, in another case is social pressure in Northern Ireland, in another case is just informal rule. So that is one. Now my point is that if the best alternative is not possible, that is to have a socialism, distribute the land, and also have some measures for against discrimination like China, that experiment has collapsed. It doesn't mean that is not significant. Arguments are not important. Arguments still continue even if you have private economy. So what do? You settle down for a second best. If first best is not possible, second best is Europe has tried. They brought the concept of social market. The education, public utility, everything is in public domain. We are privatizing education. That's another story. That issue is a separate thing. But alternatives, second best alternative are being working out in Europe. And we are also trying to a certain extent. We have to work on second. We cannot be stubborn that this is the only solution. And if this solution is not there, all other solutions are useless. No. That is an irresponsible solution then, attitude. What you have to do that in an existing situation, how do I maximize? How do I give a second best solution so that Dalit gets something? That was the argument of Gandhiji, that let the freedom come. And everybody untouchable will have that. Ambedkar said, no, I need guarantees. What is the guarantee? If it is a Hindu state, what is the guarantee that untouchable will get? So he got reservation as back as 1932. First reservation in the world. He's a pioneer. And there was a provision for reservation in employment and education also there. First man to argue out, who was a socialist, out and out socialist, sorted out the reservation policy as back as 1932. So we have to work for a second best. Now, last point I'll make, let us come to the labor and capital. Now, I think the point is that we have a public sector which is very small. And rest of it is private. Ambedkar or nobody else has said that you should have a reservation policy and protection only solution is employment, reservation in public sector. No. You need state and minority. He talks about discrimination in business. He talks about discrimination in private enterprise. He talks about discrimination in private employment. And this a larger solution. State and minority safeguard against discrimination, which is reservation in employment, is not confined to public. It is extended to private also. Because it is the private where the discrimination is present. It is much less in the public. So he never confined it. The only thing as a political solution, he had to accept. That, okay, we begin with the reservation in the public sector, but the private issue remains. The private issue came on the forefront because of there is a growing privatization. The size of the public sector, the cake has so much reduced that the share of the Dalit is now completely negligible. Now, what do we do? Now, I argued and we argued at that time that there should be some sort of an affirmative action policy in private sector, in employment, and in capital and in private enterprises also. The argument is that there is a huge discrimination. Recruitment is not made on the basis of merit, but the caste, religion, and identity matters. The MSc, I give only one statistic. Forget about my study on correspondence. But the industry to which Del Tumble has rightly mentioned, MSCB, medium, small, micro enterprise, which accounts 70% of the total. Fortunately, I have been able to look into the employment data. I think they have committed a mistake in survey that they gave the social background, caste background of the employer as well as employee. And it was brought to my notice by one of the data generators, sir, you get a wonderful table. And I say, what is that? He say, you get the proportion of the employees belonging to different caste by the caste background of the employer. So you take the high caste employer, and see in his factories, what is the proportion of the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, OBC and his own caste. You get the employer belonging to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe and the background of the caste background and ethnic background of their employees. And what do you get? I have seen the figure for 2005. That was the last. Present census is going on, MSCB. Almost 80% of the employee in the enterprises owned by high caste are from their own caste, followed by OBC. The enterprises owned by OBC, more than 80% of employees are from OBC and followed by high caste, and Dalit and ST's proportion is much less than their share in the population. This is the macro picture of the employment in this country. The private sector understood when we argued with them that no, you don't follow the merit policy. Now though it is completely gone. Ambedkar introduced the concept of public employment. He was the first who set up first employment exchange in Calcutta as a labor minister. All labor legislation credit goes to Ambedkar, not to the Communist Party. Whatever laws exist today in a comprehensive way are because of him as a labor minister. Employment exchange he introduced. Why? There has to be a transparency. Any private and public employer should take the application from that office so that there is a transparency. What has happened now? I have included the article by T.S. Popola in that paper. He said the employment recruitment through newspaper and through employment exchange has reduced to 6%, 7%. Entire recruitment is through informal channel now. And three most important channels that have emerged, I have asked one of my PhD students to work on, she is working. One is the on-campus recruitment. Where is the competition? You go to a college and ask, take the first 20. What is the guarantee that first 20s are good and the last 20s are not? Highly discriminatory recruitment method. Second, on website. You don't know the employer on the other side, on the nokri.com. You register your biodata, the fellow will give you information. You do not know what consideration he is taking, caste, religion, or merit. And then the third recruitment is contractual. That all public organization, my own institution that I am there, where if you need a class 4 employee, you should ask the contractor. Or what is this called, I don't know. Now he will send you the biodata. There are no instructions to him that you follow reservation policy because you contract labor. So he will send the people of his own religion, region, village. Highly discriminatory recruitment policy is there. The axe falls on untouchables. I have seen the unemployment rate for scheduled caste at All India and my state of Maharashtra. Maharashtra, it is 13% for Dalit as against only 6% for OBC and Maharashtra average. The unemployment among Dalit is hugely high, partly because there are no jobs, but partly because of discrimination. I think there is an issue that we will have to have some affirmative action policy, some share in employment. And the issue is well taken, that organized sectors and employment constitute a very small fraction of the total employment. But who stops you from extending it beyond the organized employment? Is there any rule that it should be confined to only organized? You can introduce a rule. I'll discuss with you in 5 minutes the case of South Africa and Malaysia, what they have done. South Africa is a country which sits on the ideological base of communism, what they have done. So there is no compulsion on you to confine reservation policy or whatever to organize. The only thing is there are difficulties in an unorganized sector, household sector, but you can overcome. So I think we should cover entire private sector, organized, unorganized, small, medium, directory employment, non-directory employment. You can have the guidelines. There is no problem. So that the untouchables have and others have some share there, and you can do a monitoring through whatever organization. Now, so I think the issues of labor can be dealt with that. But most important is the capital. Ideologically, one might differ that why do you promote private enterprise among Dalit? Fine, somebody can take a view on that. But as long as the economy based on private ownership exists, you will have to provide some access to Dalit for enterprises. Dalit on their own have come now. They have started Dicky and all that. Now you look at Malaysia and look at South Africa. What Malaysia has done? Malaysia has a policy which is such a comprehensive policy whereby they increase the ownership of capital of Malayas. And what are the methods they have followed? First, is to give licenses, financial capital and other things to start the business to relatively poor Malayas. So first, increasing the ownership of enterprises by the Malayas. But that's a much more difficult exercise. You know, you require a generation of skill to start a successful private enterprise. They have pointed out a more inclusive policy. When we use inclusive policy, we use in terms of pro-poor. It's not a World Bank policy. World Bank policies are methods, but objective is they have learned that how do you make this policy pro-poor? You can disagree with their method, but you cannot disagree with their concept. The inclusive policy is a policy which is a pro-poor policy. The whole debate from Martin Revelyan and Kakwani from India, that we should measure the impact of the on the poor of on reduction of poverty of any growth strategy, not by increasing the income of relatively better off, but of the poor. Now what Malaysia has done, they say increase the ownership of equity capital and share capital of Malayas. The ownership of Malaya, who constitutes 60% of Malaya's population, was only 2% in the share capital of private and foreign. They fixed a target in 1970 that ownership of share will increase to 30%. As on today, their share is 25%. I feel uncomfortable because this is the model which is promoting private capitalism. But that's the only way that you have. Find out other ways. They have set up the public trust and asked the Malayas put the money. And so, government put some money and they helped them to buy the equity, debenture and share. And they have gone one step ahead. What did they do? The shareholder will have a share in the management. They put a reservation in the management of foreign companies and domestic companies. So you have a share in the management. So you get a share in the management. You can check up whether Malayas are employed or not. But also you get the income. The impact of ownership of shareholding was so large on the reduction of poverty in Malaysia, you cannot imagine. They had about 60% poverty. Today it is the minimum poverty in Malaysia, 7-8%. This model of capital empowerment, forget about education and other, because we are talking about capital and labor. This was adopted by South Africa in 1990. But they mess up. Despite the fact that they had a communist tradition and the black in powers, they mess up because they introduced the model of promoting private enterprise in a manner that only some elite blacks could get this through political connections, get private enterprise. Immediately after 10 years, they realized that this is dangerous. So they borrow the model of Malaysia and introduce now. They call black economic empowerment in the context of labor. What they have done, that every household, every industry will have an affirmative action policy. There is something which you will laugh. They have gone to the extreme that to make it more poor and inclusive, they have said that all white families and household, whenever they have a black worker in their family, maid servant or whatever, they should take a responsibility of educating one person in skill education. They develop a policy for capital enhancement and for development of skill to the household level, that all whites have a responsibility to help through social responsibility, household social responsibility, you can say, compared to the corporate social responsibility. They try to make it more inclusive and more poor. We'll have to apply our mind. And I agree with those arguments that you have to have a reservation policy in a manner such that it is inclusive of poor, not, you cannot, there is a debate on inclusive policy. Let me spend 1 minute on that. What is inclusive growth and what is pro-poor growth? These all people have indicated the criteria. He said that the increase in the per capita income of the poor should be higher than that of non-poor. That the income should increase in a manner such that the share of the poor in the income should be more than their population share. That the most poor should be the participatory. They are trying. You can develop the concept of pro-poorness and inclusiveness in a manner that you focus on the poor. Other will oppose. There is no doubt about that. They say, in that case, how can rich invest if they don't get the share in the increased income? So you work out on the share. There is no problem about that. Now that is what South Africa is doing now. They are measuring every element of black empowerment policy by the measure that to what extent it helps poor and reduce poverty. So I will submit that we will have to apply our mind. Asking for a safeguard and share in private sector is not rhetoric. One has to really understand it and one has to develop a policy. I think Sudhir has rightly given you all alternative. I mean, the way alternative he has given. We also need an equal opportunity office, not employment office, for the private sector. And we need a law. I have given you a story. I was involved in this affirmative action policy, which is self-regulatory and voluntary, for 5 years academically, accused of all kind of things. You always want share, you always want this, you are incompetent and all that. For finally, when we provide an evidence that you are discriminated, you discriminate, one of the, I won't name the particular company in Pune, more than 60% of their employees are from the Marathas and the Brahmins, much above the population share of these two groups. So we gave the evidence, they agreed. But what is the nature of the policy? Voluntary and self-regulatory. CIA has 9,000 members. There are 20 code of affirmative action policy which they have, 20 or 25. Everybody has to sign that I respect this code, that I don't discriminate, that I will follow this policy, that policy. How many of them have signed? Only 800, which comes to 12% of the total member of CIA. This is the commitment. You do need a law. I don't think voluntarism works in India, given the in-depth caste attitude, prevalent anti-caste attitude, in fact, anti-spirit that prevails in every sphere of life. I found Jafet was discouraged that you should prepare the act, make it more comprehensive. We should take help of Tel Tumde because he has that vision. But I think we cannot go backward. Thank you very much.